So when tense things happened in the news, and we talk immediately about just the horrific events that took place in El Paso and in Texas, and they're really about competing interest and polarization in our country. So I want to focus a bit on something just to get our minds off of it, and I'll come back to it. Nothing will take your mind off of tragedies like celebrity gossip. Okay, so let's go to this first, and I'll bring and wrap it around and come back to it. So people in our community are dating, and people have asked me about, in numerous occasions, about prenups. Okay? Well, prenups, and I won't give you an answer. If you want to really know, come talk to me, okay? Maybe you're from Means and you need one, but probably a lot of you don't need it. You're like, prenup, why? I have 25 cents to my name. Makes no sense to get a prenup, pun intended. Now, so, you know, people have asked me about prenups, you know, so they got, you know, Aaron Grande and Pete Davidson, we know from SNL. We totally knew that this was a rebound when they dated. The most accomplished person from Staten Island is Pete Davidson. When this happened, he got engaged to her, I believe, you know. And, you know, they got a prenup. I mean, what is a prenup about? Well, it's about competing interests, right? One party, depending on the columns in your net worth, has little to lose, or the other party has what? A lot to lose. And depending on what those columns are, they're about competing interest. And in celebrity marriages, the percentage is really horrific. Most likely, if a celebrity gets married, they will what? End up in divorce, right? I mean, we've seen this over and over again. Celebrities have 2-3 marriages. You know, the greatest celebrity is the president of the United States of America, and he has, what, 3 marriages. And so, is a prenup make sense if your column is high? Well, some people say, well, it's about competing interests. It does make sense because you have more to lose. I remember when we were first getting, my wife and I first got married, and we did life insurance and stuff like that. You know, I went by myself to do life insurance, and they asked me, I go, so do you want to protect yourself with prenup? I said, why? Because, you know, if all this money accumulates, you want to protect your interest. I said, give it to her if we get divorced. Because we're not. And they're like, he goes, oh, I just want to advise you as your financial advisor. This is not a good idea. I've seen ugly divorces, even with Christians. Well, I'm like a pastor, so if that happens, then she deserves all the money. as a point, you know, of contention, right? So it's really about who has more to lose. In fact, if you go to another celebrity marriage, this really recently happened, you know, between JB and Haley Baldwin, now Haley Bieber, whatever it is, in this Vogue. I mean, Justin Bieber is worth around, they say, $500 million. She's worth around $5 million. They have no prenup. It's all about love for them. But, you know, I don't know. You know, like, some people say Justin's going to break up with Haley soon because he's still in love with Selena Gomez. I think, you know, sometimes I don't really get into the celebrity gossip stuff. And I know I've written an article right now that's, you know, going viral about really important stuff. But, you know, this stuff interests me too. But I think he might be in love with Selena Gomez. I don't know. I'm confused. He even wrote a song about it, you know. You know, and he was so upset, he even said that my mom likes everyone, but not you. Remember that song? I'm sorry. I mean, but anyway, let me get back to the point, okay? But here is human nature. In human nature, when you have nothing, it's easy to commit to things. When you have nothing to lose, you take amazing risks. And you go on these adventures, and you say yes to many things because you have nothing to lose. See, what happens is when you begin to accumulate assets through ascension, whether through degrees, through titles, through positions, and capitalization, and you begin to grow your net worth, you want to protect your interests more and more. And so those two things, like love and commitment to things like values, they come into collision, they come into conflict. Last week I talked about how Abram, who eventually in Genesis 22 becomes Abraham, his name is changed, the founder of monotheism, the founder of Judaism, and biblically speaking, right, the beginning promise of Jesus coming into fruition in the Gospels in the New Testament. How do you know that Abraham had real faith? How can you see real evidence of real faith in someone's life? Because you see, when you're young and you're flexible and you're single, you know, and you're in your 20s and your teens, you know, church is great because you might meet someone that you marry. Like a lot of people in our church, they're married as a benefit. And you're going to a small group is easy because you have nothing else to do. You got no kids to watch. Trust me, that's hard. That's another job in itself. Just look at the rates of how much we pay nannies in Manhattan. Okay? And they want benefits now, too, because they know how hard it is. But the more and more you accumulate, it's difficult, right? So Abram, in this story of Genesis, you've seen him in Genesis 12 come out of Pharaoh's house. And we talked about this last week. He lied. He had some character flaws about his wife, and he comes out. But when he comes out with a lot of stuff. In a sense, because of the promise of God in his life and the hand of God on his life, he becomes very wealthy. And that's the tension of the text in Genesis 13. And you see now he has more to lose than less. Right? Because he becomes, and now his nephew Lot, who's actually older than him, by the way. Strange things happen in Mesopotamia Valley. Don't ask how or why. But, you know, they have to part ways because of the accumulation of stuff. And so when you begin to look at Abraham's life through the lens of economics, an economic lens, you begin to see what real faith looks like when you begin to acquire more stuff. And you'll begin to see that even though Abraham was flawed and his worship and his faith was flawed, his faith and worship was genuine. Amen? A lot of us in this room, right? You're flawed, aren't you? And a lot of people, you're definitely flawed. So am I. But how can you tell? How can you tell that Abram just said yes to God because he needed a son and his wife was barren and he had to follow the promise? But how do you know that he had real faith? And I think Genesis 13 is empirical evidence that he had real faith. Even though he had shady dealings and character tensions, he had real, genuine faith. So I want to prove that to you. Where's the evidence of real faith in his life? It's the question I want to answer. So let's go to this text and kind of parallel to our lives. It will be a challenge to us. So Abraham went from Egypt, right? We saw that, to Negev with his wife. And everything he had, a lot went with him. Abraham had become very what? Wealthy. In livestock and in silver and gold. And it says that in verse 10, because they had a tension of so much accumulation of wealth that they had to part ways. So Lot chooses to part ways by looking at what? The whole plain of the Jordan toward Zoar as well watered like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt. So look at this. They both have become wealthy. Why be on a mission? Why continue your journey when right near the Euphrates River, right near Egypt, is a beautiful landscape, well-watered plains. You know, it's like getting a house in Malibu. That's just some of your dreams, right? You want a house near, like, a beach, a dream home, where you can kick back and drink those little umbrella drinks like the whole day and not go to work. Some people want to do this, right? I mean, it's that's what people are all working toward, their assets, their 401k, 401b, retirements, investments, asset, you know, all of this, asset allocations, et cetera, et cetera. This is what they're working toward. This dream of being near a beautiful place with beautiful people and beautiful umbrella drinks. And so they acquired enough wealth, they didn't have to continue the mission. And Lot says, you know what, I'm going to settle here. I'm going to stop. I'm not going to go anymore. I want to stop at this beautiful place, buy a mansion, and be chilling. Right? But if you look at verse 18, it says that Abram, right, where it says here in verse 18, where he what? He pitched his what? Tents. There he built an altar to the Lord. He didn't stop. He had the assets necessary to settle down near the Euphrates. But he decided to live in a tent. Tell someone, he lived in a tent. I want you to propose to someone one day and say, hey, you know, I have a great idea. I want to live a tent in Africa. Let's become a missionary. 5 seconds, no. Unless, like, you know, you guys are called for that. But it's not an attractive lifestyle. But here it is. A lot of you could live in a tent because you have no money. Right? I mean, that's just the reality. It might save you money. Live in Central Park, no rent to pay, no cost, no electricity. You know, just get a gym membership, go shower. Might be the fastest way to get out of debt and pay your school loans, whatever. It might be the smartest thing to do. But for Abraham, he acquired great wealth. So there is this paradox, there is this tension of someone very wealthy choosing to live nomadic, choosing to live in a tent, the billionaire tent maker. And that's where you see, even though he's flawed, you begin to see he's on mission. Yeah, his character, he has those issues like a lot of us, self-preservation. I don't want to die. You know, I don't want to lose. He has all those anxieties, all those fears that we have, but he's on a mission. He has not abandoned to settle down, even though he has what? The means to do so. He's living in a tent. A billionaire tent. Who does that? So you begin to see the emotional ecology behind the scenes of Abraham's life, why he became the father of faith. You see, even though he had kinks to work out in his character, his direction was flawless. His heart for God, even though it failed, was there. Because he lived nomadically, sporadically, and he followed. I know this disparity and this polarity in my own life with believers that have great wealth. I'm on the board in an organization with the grandkids of Hobby Lobby. Hobby Lobby's equivalent to the Michaels here. You know the arts and crafts? All you artists right now, you should be thinking of how to make arts and crafts supplies to stores. It's a $1 billion business, all right? That family is worth like $8 billion. And they had a vote a few years ago where they said, we're going to give you all the shares of Hobby Lobby to each members of the family. And they gave out all the shares, and those shares were worth hundreds of millions of dollars. And the two people I know, the grandkids, said, we don't want them. Said, gave it back to them. And then we heard the story, and we're like, why? Can you have like 10%? You know, it's like, why would you do that? They go, because that's not our mission. They work for Hobby Lobby. They work for the Museum of the Bible. They started all that. But they're like, that's not our goal. We don't want our life to be about not able to do nothing. It will ruin our lives. And so many of you are hearing this, you're like, it won't ruin your life. It'll solve all my problems right now. It's incredible to me, a lot of the high net worth individuals I meet that are believers got that way because they have something called values. Money is a utility to them. It is not their identity. It is not their idol. Hundreds of million dollars in front of them, they could just sign and leave, and they'd be set for life. But no, they give it away. They said, we want, and that's why Hobby Lobby can give 50% of all sales, not profits, all sales to the Christian mission. And people can say a lot of things about Hobby Lobby and the political sphere and all of this and the conservative things that they do. They can say all that, you know what? And that's fine. Not necessarily saying I agree with everything, but hey, they embody faith. They put their money where their mouth is. And then in the last two decades, I have met people that are like peasants. Peasants, like, compared to hundreds of millions to 50,000. Can't tithe to God. Can't do it. And the funny thing is, I talked to peeps about this. We helped them get the jobs. We put them in there. We did their resumes. We wrote the recommendations, but can't do it. This is an outrage. How can I do that? How can I afford my lifestyle if I do that? It's this paradox. And a lot of those people that I've met in the two decades of ministry, a lot of people have said to me, don't worry, Pastor Sam, one day when I become a millionaire, I'm gonna back you up. Please, man, I'll become a billionaire before you can do that. Because you have no values. Your value is money and status and mobility. And the only reason sometimes people accept Christ or church or community is because you have nothing. You have no friends. You have no job. So, hey, why not? You have nothing to lose. And so what happens is in the church, there's a lot of utilitarianism. And I've been talking about this. This might be my next article. Maybe I'll preach it now and write it later. I mean, it's true. People are utilitarians because you have more to lose. And you see in Abram's life, he was incredibly wealthy, but he chose to live in a tent. So how do you know he had real faith in spite of his character tensions in the story of Genesis? First lesson we learned, the evidence. Read that with me. Look at what? His? Even with his what? And capitalization. Everything about economics tells us that he should not have lived the way he did. Because he was a billionaire living in a tent, meeting kings. And the most powerful leader of of Mesopotamian Valley, which is Egypt, meeting leaders and kings, yet he chose to live in a tent because of a promise from God. And here's what a lot of young people don't seem to understand about putting God in the center of your life. And this is not a pitch. You go, I want you to tithe more. This has nothing to do with that. This is about values. I want you to understand the values of real faith. Even though you might be, struggling in your life in some shady areas of your character, and you're afraid and you're anxious, and that's all good. And people can do that. But what I'm saying is there has to be restrictions economically if you have real faith. And Abraham shows that. He doesn't go out, buy jets, like three of them. He doesn't buy a helicopter to commute to work like Kobe Bryant does. Okay, that's the LA traffic is pretty bad. That's warranted. Okay, that's okay. But when the Lehman Brothers presidents and vice presidents begin to ride helicopters from one Manhattan skyscraper to Lehman, we knew that a crisis was coming. But you see, that's Wall Street, right? And I don't hate Wall Street. We need, free markets to do good. We need believers to acquire assets like Abraham did. But you see, here's the thing. The point is, a lot of us complain about how much we have, yet we don't have the character or the values to acquire more. And that's why you're not going to acquire more. Not from God anyway. And you look at this. Are there restrictions in your life? Are there values in your life? Whether it's $1 million or $10, can you put God in the center? Because if you study Genesis carefully, the whole Bible, Abraham doesn't tithe his gross income. Because, I mean, how are you going to count sheep and cows and, you know, and maybe silver and gold? He gives a tenth, if you see later, to a high priest of God. He gives 10% of his net assets. He went over and beyond. And then you go, how did he acquire so much wealth? How did he become blessed? How did he say yes to God? He had what? His heart was right. And that's some of us. We need to get our heart right. That's real faith. You can't keep talking about faith and not back it up. So how do you know Abraham had real faith? Well, look at his restrictions. Even with his ascension and accumulation of wealth, he lives in a tent. He's on mission. What happens to people who acquire a lot of stuff? You know, when you're young, when you're single, you got a lot of time. You're a computer programmer. You can work from home. You're a financial analyst. You can do whatever you want. You have all kinds of mobility, right? You can live in an island. But when you begin to have more commitments, more assets, more, you know, competing obligations, it becomes more difficult. And if you don't have the values now, you're never going to get the values. And that's why people stop coming to church, right? Because now they got to go to this and to that and there and this because they acquired more stuff. And eventually what? You stop living on mission. It's all about competing interests. So this is the question I have for you today. What's the competing interest in your life? What competes with the kingdom's interest, the Lord's interest, and your interest? That collision will tell you where you are at spiritually. Because the truth is, you have your own values, you have your own Lord in those areas. And I pray the Spirit of God will show you. And it doesn't just have to be around money. It could be about many things. So we look at his restrictions, right? His restraint despite of his enormous wealth. Okay, so let's move down. So from Negev, he went from place to place. You see that, a nomadic lifestyle, a fasted lifestyle, in spite of his enormous wealth, enormous, you know, riches. He came to the place he called Bethel. Remember the altar he created from and the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar, there Abram called on the name of the Lord. So Abram went to live the near, right, of the great trees. And he got there. And then what? Where he pitched his tent. There he built an altar to the Lord. Every place Abram went to, he built an altar to the Lord. What do you begin to see in Abram's life? You begin to see a style of worship, a life of worship. Yeah, he lied about his wife. He actually does it again later. So if many of you are thinking, well, Abraham was different than me. No, he wasn't. He's just like you. You know? He was as shady as many of you right now in this room. But God is the artist of the soul. He worked in his life and made him a man after God's heart. But that tension was always there. So the tension is necessary. The struggle is real about putting God first, about having kingdom values. That's necessary. You see that his worship was flawed and his faith was flawed, but it was sincere and real. See that? You know, my son and my kids, my wife and I, we have a different approach than other pastors' kids, the way we try to lead them to a lifestyle of worship. You know, We've seen the previous pastor's kids, you know. And here's the thing about pastor's kids, folks, if you've grew up in church. They're really good, like Paul and Grace, they're really good. They don't even sin, okay? And they're the really bad PKs. Like, Satan is bad, right? They're like, so because either you become an angel, right? I mean, you become like, you know, Mother Teresa types, better than your parents, or you become, my goodness, the devil incarnate. Because the previous generation of how we try to impute or pass down our faith was, you're gonna remember a Bible verse to eat. You're going to read the Bible 5 times, 8 times. And then it was what? It was forced down their throat. You're going to be a man of God. And then there's the Korean style prayer. They would hit you in the back, pray for you out loud. Your back would be bruised. You know, I mean, it was bad. It was, and you know, and the people just like, you know, a lot of times I remember growing up in the Korean church and I was just like, why do they hit you when they pray for you? It's just like, this doesn't make any sense. And there's this behaviorism, right? It's all about the battle of behavior. Don't do this. Don't do that. No, you can't go to the dance. No, you can't listen to secular music. Justin Bieber, devil music. Harry Potter, burn it, witchcraft. I mean, you know, it's just no, none of that. None of that. For us, we know people are going to curse. Junior high school kids curse. When I was in junior high school, man, every word I used was profanity, some type of profanity. I felt powerful. But I was, of course, I was this good Asian kid in school, but outside playing on the court, talk trash like there's no tomorrow, cursing at everybody, you know what I'm saying? It's just bad. And so I know, so we don't restrict cursing or explicit music. We just let it go. We bring them to all the movies. Sex scenes? Oh, well. It's not like they don't have something called the internet. It's not like they can discover it. But you know what? We're there. Every single moment to talk about things. Because what? It's a battle of what? A battle of not behavior, but battle of the heart. And if we win the heart, we win the day. And we win long term. You restrict, what do? They rebel. And some of my kids are, I mean, they're, both of them are really good at rebelling. That's their spiritual gift. And you know, you don't know if their faith is real or not. How do you know when they're that young? You know, and recently, you know, my oldest son, Nathan, he's trying to launch a rap career. You see, if I told my parents when I was 12, Mom, Dad, I'm going to be a rapper, they would have went to jail for murder. I'm serious. They would have murdered me. No doubt. My dad would have murdered me. They would not have, we have sacrificed everything so you could fail as a rapper. We didn't sacrifice for you to become a, I mean, I'm a nice parent, right? I mean, my son wants to be a rapper. I pay for his SoundCloud account, you know what I'm saying? I mean, so he can't ever say he's self-made. We made that very clear. Now, but, you know, pay attention to what I'm saying. This is important. But we support that. And you know, kids, You know, just like J. Cole, right? He says in one of the songs, 1985, he says, you got to give a boy time to grow some. I think that's profound and wise. We have to give time to grow some. So he raps about, you know, in the beginning, we listened to some of his earlier music. He has no experience with any of that he's talking about, being G. And I mean, I grew up 5 blocks from the hood. You know, just letting you know, in a very turbulent time in Manhattan in the 1990s, okay? But my son, I mean, he's a suburb kid, you know what I'm saying? He's rapping about all this, he's cursing, there's a lot of profanity. It's just, you know. But recently he said that he was inspired. and wrote his first Christian song. And actually, we're going to release it one day at church. Amin Lee, who's also an artist and filmmaker, he's going to come on a guest track. And I'm getting ready for this, but he wrote a Christian song, and we heard it. And my doubts disappeared, because he actually rapped without profanity. He rapped about Christ, his death, salvation. And my wife and I heard it, and honest to God, we started... His faith is real. His faith is real, mama. It's super real. Thank God he saved. Because trust me, 1 year before, we were like, oh, this kid is lost. He's lost. He is super lost. Lord, we don't know. Have mercy. Because, you know, none of us cut, you know, when we were growing up or do anything kind of things like that. We were good Asian kids, you know what I'm saying? We were really good. Actually, my wife cut. I didn't. Okay. But, and we see that his faith was imperfect and his worship was in, you know, you couldn't see it. You know, we don't do QTs as a family that other pastors' families do sometimes. And a lot of PKs hate their families for that, the QT thing. Or we don't have elaborate prayer times around meals and 30 minutes pray for North Korea and South Africa. And, you know, we don't do that kind of thing. We want the value to be intrinsic and visceral. So, and then you see that in Abram's life, and you see that in my son's life. You know, real faith doesn't always look explicit. It's implicit and subtle sometimes, but it's real, and you see it in Abram's life. Even though he messes up, you see his heart for worship. You see his heart toward reaching out to the Lord. Right? So how do you know he had real evidence of real faith? Well, second, read it with me. Look at what? His direction. Despite some troubling tensions in his life, I look at my kids' direction despite some troubling tensions in their lives. I look also at your direction despite, tell somebody, despite some troubling tensions in your, some shady tensions in your life. Oh, folks, it's about direction. It's not about perfection. It's not about getting it perfectly right. It's not about being the model Christian. Abraham wasn't. Peter, Apostle Peter wasn't. Apostle Paul wasn't. No Christian ever was. It's about your direction. Do you want to worship him? Do you want to put him first? And your heart is always bigger than the life you have for God. And what you're hoping for is that your life catches up. So today, despite where you might be, in spite of, and even if, where you might be today, do you have the desire to worship God? Put him first. Even though your life doesn't match up yet, there's incongruence there. There's disparity there. There's distance there. That's real faith. The tension you feel is necessary. Let's stand and pray together. Where is your direction with God today? Now, I'm not talking about a list. Did you do your QT check? Did you go to service check? Did you pray check? Well, I'm not talking about a list. Because actually, lists don't work. I don't think you have a list about how to love your wife. Because that would be really strange. She goes, thank you, honey. You did something so nice for me. Yeah, I was on my list of things to do. That might end in divorce. See, the battle of behavior versus the battle of heart. The battle of heart always wins. The heart will do what it wants. And what the enemy will tell many of you that are struggling today in your faith is, you'll never be real. You'll always be like this. And try to guilt you. Yeah, see, that's the problem with this generation. You don't read the Bible anymore, so you don't even know what the Bible says. And you look at Abraham's life, and he's just as shady as us. But You begin to see evidence, implicit evidence of his heart and intentions for God and reaching out to God, like many of you today. So will you tell the Lord, Lord, I do have a desire to worship you. I do have a desire to put you first. I do have those desires, but there are parts of me that cowards out, that's scared. Match my heart with my life. And it's not about, hey, what have I began to do or begun to do? It's about the direction. So let's come to the Lord today in our direction. Say, Lord, I'm coming to you. I say, yes, help me. Help me. Folks, this is how we're going to close today. When I wrote this piece about the southern border, it was a political piece. I was just giving facts based on government statistics on what was happening. It wasn't from CNN, and it wasn't from Fox News. It was from GOV, from the Trump administration site directly, and I gave the facts. Not influenced by any sources except the government's. I responded to one comment because there were thousands of comments and I didn't want my Facebook to be flooded with hate mail or love mail. But this is what someone said. I can't believe a Christian magazine is telling other Christians to stop killing people. Okay, I'm sorry. So I like sarcasm. It wins me over. And I responded, sometimes you have to state the obvious. Oh, I say this is because sometimes we have to state the obvious for you, because sometimes our issues are missing. We miss in plain sight. What I'm telling you today is something really obvious. Like the Bible says it in the greatest commandment, to love your God with what? All your heart, mind, soul, and strength. All I'm telling you is, in conclusion, is honor God with your life for no other reason except to honor God. I'm not giving you a prosperity message. Hey, if you honor God, God will bless you. God will make you rich. If you do it for that motive, then you're going to abandon God at some point, right? Because your real idol is money. It's prosperity, success, whatever that might be. Today, what I'm telling you is just a biblical command from the Torah to the New Testament. Honor God for the sake of honoring God. As A.B. Simpson once, a great theologian in the 1800s, once said, first, it was the blessing, but now it is the Lord. First, it was the gifts. Now, it's the giver. Will you love God and honor God because? Not because of a reward. That's where real change begins. When you move from a Trinitarian, when you move from a utilitarian lens and move toward a Trinitarian reality. I love God because He's good. I love God because He's faithful. I love God because He deserves honor and worship. That, it's reward itself. Will you bow your heads in prayer? In Genesis 12, when God says, I will bless you to make you a blessing, He says to Abram this one statement I think could apply to all of us today in our anxieties and our fears of what the tension of what it means to move in the direction of God's kingdom and God's mission. He says, I will bless you, and I'll make you great, and I'll turn you into a great nation. But He says, I will be your shield and your great reward. Until God becomes your great reward above all else, those competing interests will always eat you alive underneath, around. No one will be more faithful to you. No one will be as steadfast. No one will honor you and love you like the Lord. So just logically honor Him. Will you bow your heads for the benediction? Lord, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. All God's people say, amen. God bless you. Go in peace.